All right. Well, this is kind of a sequel to the cornbread video. And this is a video about how I make chili. I think it's not real unusual, but maybe a little unique in that I use a pressure cooker. And there's some specific reasons why I do that. Mainly because it's quicker and it does a real good job. One of those situations where necessity gives birth to some new idea that turns out to be better than the current practice. And so this is not a video that is posted to give other folks instruction about how to make chili. You may not want to make chili this way. I wouldn't blame you if you didn't. And you'll see in the video whether or not you think this is a good idea or not. But this is a video about how I make chili. Don't try this at home, because while I may not be a professional, I do know that I have never gotten sick in the past from eating chili that's made this way. So first of all, I have my pressure cooker here. It's not that big. It's one I've had for many years, and so I think I bought it at a time when I was going on the cheap on most things. It's not very good. I have to coax it to start to hold some pressure, so I would not advise you to buy this particular pressure cooker. It's not very good, and who knows, it could be dangerous. Comes with this thing in there. I never use it. I'm sure there's some good things, good reasons why you want to use this, but not. I don't use it for chili anyway. I have tried it in the past and didn't really notice any benefit. So what I'm going to do is the first thing that I'm going to show you. Oh, that's good. Well, those go in there anyway. Is put these pinto beans in here, and the rest of them I'm going to measure. See, I had all this set up, but I opened that up, and there's some beans down here. My dog will eat them, and his stomach might explode. I use some dried pinto beans, and this is one of the few things I actually do measure, because when you're making dried beans, you got to make sure you got enough, got the right amount of water in there. And this is a recipe I use 2 cups. So 2 cups of dried pinto beans go into the pressure cooker. And what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to put some water in there. Now this is a situation on the instructions for the beans. They will tell you to mix these beans with 6 to 8 cups of water and bring them to a boil, and then remove it from the heat and drain it. And that's, you know, what you're gonna soak the beans in. Why they tell you to measure out 6 to 8 cups, which I would never do 6 to 8 cups, I would do 7 cups, I always split the difference anyway, is a mystery to me, because you get rid of the water. It's very silly. But I will do the soaking part, and I'm gonna get that started. The good thing, one thing you gotta remember is that rice and beans grow on the ground, near the ground. And a lot of dirt, including sandy particles and stuff, get in there. So it's a good idea good idea to rinse them. This is one thing you can use the little strainer on the bottom for, kind of keep your beans in there, keep them from coming out when you're draining out the water when you rinse them. And I usually rinse that rinse those beans a couple of times, and so we'll go throw a couple of times for that. I don't know if you can see that or not, but it's not important. All I'm doing is rinsing beans. So do that. You can tell if you're rinsing beans, a bunch of stuff starts coming out of there, like especially if you've gotten some beans out of somebody's garden. I don't know anybody that grows pinto beans, but if you do, some might be a little less processed than others, and so they might be a little dirtier. So you got to watch that. But those were, you know, the water was coming out pretty clean. So I wasn't spending too much time. One thing I will do from time to time though, is put a little oil on my seal. Use olive oil for just about everything. I guess it's FDA approved or whatever. So, and stick this back in there. I don't know if it really helps much, but like I said before, I kind of have to coax this thing to hold some pressure. Anyway, so every little bit helps. And so we'll do that. Trying to get olive oil on everything. Now, later on, I'll use that measuring cup for something. The water for the beans. At a time when it actually matters. Now, what I want to do is get this frying pan out. I know what I did. I've got about 5 pounds, maybe not that much, but I've got a lot of turkey left over from a Christmas dinner. And you know, just turkey, roasted turkey sliced up, kind of gets old after a while, so I was frying it. And frying it with some grilling spices and stuff. And it actually turned out pretty good. That flavor is still in there. And I think I'll leave it in there. Now this meat, this is why we get to the part in the video where I caution you. This is how I make chili, okay? This meat, I don't know how old this meat is. It's old. It's been in my refrigerator for a long time. And I'll tell you, I had problems with my thermostat and it would freeze everything. And then it would thaw and then it would freeze. And so this stuff's been there in the bottom where it freezes mostly. Did thaw every once in a while, and it's been in there for, well, I won't say exactly how long because it's way too long, but I don't worry about it. And then again, this is a video about how I make chili. I really didn't want to open the refrigerator door while we had company over, which primarily would be girlfriends of my sons, and they probably wouldn't have liked that because you know, when people talk about after a battle, you know, the smell of the battlefield and the bodies and stuff like that, this meat probably, I think it approximates that somewhat. After a while, I did have a roast one time I made some chili out of, and I had to actually wash, there was some kind of stuff growing on it, and I had to wash that off. But the good thing about that roast was it had a lot of fat. Had a lot of fat. Now this stew meat doesn't have a lot of fat on it, but fat is good in the chili because it kind of gives it it thickens it up. I've seen chili recipes that had flour in them and they were trying to thicken up like the chili. All that's gonna, I mean, well, I started to say that's gonna make gravy when you put flour in something like that, and it'll thicken it up like gravy with, you know, because gravy's got flour in there, but you need fat too. I mean, you can't make gravy without fat. Or at least gravy, sawmill gravy that I'm familiar with. The beans are trying to get warmed up there. Now, but later on, this, like I said, this stew meat doesn't have a whole lot of fat. So later on, we're going to add a little fat because I like that. The chili kind of gets some body to it when it gets some fat in there. Now, this meat, I don't want a chunk of meat that big. Now, some people might like that, but I would rather have a smaller, like a bite-sized chunk. That might be bite-sized for some people. But I'm going to take my knife here and just maybe cut a piece like that into thirds, maybe something in that range. Now, this meat is going to, because it's going to go in that pressure cooker, it's going to get real tender. So you don't have to get them real small. They'll just kind of fall apart on you. About that size, about fork size right there. And it's better if the bottom part, I think I mentioned my refrigerator, it's a little too cold on the bottom. It's kind of like that. I like to keep it that way because the meat's a little bit more frozen. It's a little stiffer. It's easier to cut. This meat's gotten a little bit thawed out. It's been sitting here for a little bit. But I'm getting some frozen stuff in there now. And I'll probably cut a little bit of this out of the video because I'm going to stand here and cut this meat. But we'll put some of that. I'll probably add a little bit of oil in there because what I'd like to do is get that meat in there and brown it a little bit. And you can't really do that without some oil. And like I said, this meat, that's smelling good. Got a little bit of color to it too. It's probably gonna make some good chili. All right, now, as I was saying, yeah, I like to brown it a little bit. Now, you might be able to put raw meat through a pressure cooker and be okay. I don't know. I've always browned it. This meat's so nasty that I kind of feel like a belt and suspenders approach is probably good, you know. My boys, they don't really particularly care to hear about the meat or smell the meat, but they always like the chili. Chili is one of their favorites, so they try to dismiss the whole meat thing from their minds until you know, while they're eating it, I should say. Now, while I'm cutting up this meat, I have several theories about the meat. And one of them is, if you let it sit here, kind of age a little bit, some aged meat, seems like I've seen someplace, somebody watching this probably seen, got away from me there. Fingers. You know, when you're digging around in frozen stuff, your fingers tend to kind of get a little bit numb. I've seen on menus before, you know, fancy restaurants where meat will be, you know, aged. Well, maybe this is getting some of that process done. But anyway, the end result is that the meat is super good and very, very tender. So there's doubtless some kind of living colonial activity going on there on the surface of some of these chunks of meat. And, you know, we're going to be eating the residue of that habitat as well. So, I mean, I am, not you, but you're not going to do this. But, you might get some ideas. I almost cut my finger off. I think that'd be bad to cut your finger while you're cutting this stuff here. You'd probably need to get a shot or something. chili. My understanding of chili is that people in situations, you know, like I always heard, maybe cowboys on the range or whatever, you know, they'd be someplace where they, you know, had to live off provisions, you know, that they had packed with them. And, you know, and no packing list is perfect. And so you get in the situation where you get down to the bottom of the barrel, you know, kind of like the Donner family or whatever situations. And you need to make something edible that otherwise might be a little rough. And so that's where chili kind of came from. Just put everything in a pot, cook it to submission, and then while you're doing that, add some spice, some flavor, to maybe, you know, cover up the fact that the meat. Oh yeah, that's doing good in there. We'll let that come to a boil, and we're about done with this meat. Edit some of this meat cut out, but it's got to be done. But yeah, chili. And so if you're putting fine cuts of sirloin or something like, I'm not one of these that's some kind of purist. Like I've had, and so you can do what you want, you know, put some turkey or something in there, I don't care, but it's going to taste like turkey chili. But you know, I'm speaking of purists, I used to know a man who was he was a volunteer youth program guy at a church I grew up in. One of the greatest men who ever had who I ever knew, he was proud of where he came from, which was Texas, and we made chili, my brother and I, we made chili back when I was still struggling to find my own recipe, but I showed him the product I made for our, we had a chili dinner to, well, it was a benefit, you know, kind of like pancake breakfast, but we had a chili dinner. And he saw the kidney beans, and he used a slur to describe my chili, which I easily forgave him for, because as I said, he was a very great man, but called my chili Tennessee bean soup. But then he had a taste of it, and he said, "Well, it's not bad." So, but I still like beans in the chili. It's just that if I make something with just meat, it seems like it's just something that ought to go on a hot dog instead of actually eat with a spoon. But so that's the meat. Probably what I'll do is I'll rinse this off, and I think the beans are about to boil. Here they are. So we'll let those go a little bit. Not long. Just kind of soak in a little bit of that water while they're boiling. I'm not even sure if that's necessary, but we'll see. Someday we can try it without it, but right now we'll just let it. We'll stick at least that part of the directions. All of this comes from the same people that tell you to put sugar in your cornbread, which if you watch my other videos, you'll know how I feel about that. It's not good. Neither are eggs. No eggs and no sugar, unless you want to make corn muffins. And if you have your cornbread, if you have cornbread like I make it in the cornbread video with this chili, you will spit on crackers. You will spit on crackers for the rest of your days, because you will know the scales will have fallen from your eyes, and you will have seen the light and realized that saltines have no place on this chili. But man cornbread is it's a staple. It's not a must, but it is very much favored as a good addition. It helps. We get by with a little help from our friends like cornbread. Now, we've rinsed that off. We're going to put this on some heat. Medium to medium high. We're going to need to get, like I said, I'm going to put a little oil in here. And so we'll get a little bit of browning action going, some frying action. We'll let those brown a little bit. Get those beans in just a second, get them ready, but I'm gonna go ahead and chop up. There's just a few things I put in this chili. Now, this onion, I think this is a victim of the old the thermostat issues that we had earlier. That's okay. I mean, this is a nasty looking onion. It looks like it's been frozen and then thawed out a couple of times, but that's okay. But this is chili. All I wanna do is just get some flavor out of this onion. So I'm not going to slice it up and try to present it on a hamburger or anything, but I'm going to go around and cut a little slice off there. Probably one little slice, about a quarter or 3/8 thick, and slice it up real small. Now remember what I'm doing here is slicing this real small. Now, I got people in my family, there is some kind of gene in the green that gets handed down from the green family. I think it's one of those things where it skips generation. It can skip mine, or maybe no, because my brother, he has this affliction as well. They hate onions. My father hates onions. My brother, LC, he hates onions too. I love onions. But those individuals have told me that they can compromise if an onion is cooked well enough, and there may be just some flavor, but not the carcass of the onion remaining in the food they're trying to eat, especially a raw onion. Raw onion on a salad, that must be picked through and gotten rid of. Now, the next thing, some old, that one's too old. Let's see. Yeah, that might work. See, that one's got something. I think it's got something growing on it. But we don't want to use that. But I did get some backup. This one, I don't want to use that in, but we'll put this up here. Yeah, I think that's good. I looked at that, thought, there's a little onion. All right, now, that's a little soft, but it's good. That's okay, it's got flavor. I did get another onion, or a jalapeno. Did I mention it's a jalapeno? Okay, it's a jalapeno. I was at a store yesterday. I like to refer to it as Whole Paycheck because they sell expensive things there. based on the idea that they were never touched by any sort of processed chemical. And got these jalapenos, so they ought to be extra specially good. Now I think together those two make about one jalapeno pepper, and we're going to do the same thing, actually a little bit more aggressive to the jalapeno. Why? Because if you cut up a jalapeno like most people, and I'm going to show you in a second. Well, I'll go ahead and show you now. These jalapenos on this chili, people slice them up and they put them out there. A little slice is like an 8 to 3/16 inch thick, not quite a quarter inch thick, life preserver of hot jalapeno flavor. So you eat one of those and you take, jalapeno, wait, whoa, that's a lot of jalapeno, that's really hot. Ooh, I better get something to drink. And then you eat some more and it goes away. And then you, I got another hot jalapeno life preserver. No, that's crazy. Chop them up, and the more you chop them up, the more surface area there is to infuse the rest of the chili with the great natural flavor of jalapeno. Chop them up. You should never even actually see the jalapeno once you have put it in the chili, or at least I don't. Once again, this is my recipe, not yours. All right. So, starting to get some action over here on this meat. That's good. Beans are cooling down. We're going to take care of this jalapeno, and then we're going to take care of the beans, because everything's going to start going together. And then we're going to sign off and sign back when it's time to release the pressure and see what we've got inside. Now, I start off slicing these up like most people do, but then I'm going to come back and just chunk them up. Now, change the number of jalapenos, the number of peppers, according to how hot you like your chili. This is the best way that I like to, make my chili hotter, because pretty much I've gotten calibrated. My eyeball's calibrated to how many peppers I need to put in there to make it as hot as I like it. Now, you might not like it as hot. Well, don't put as many in. Because you're chopping them up real fine, you're dispersing the pieces. Well, then a smaller amount can have a more homogeneous effect on the flavor of your chili. That's what we're going after. Homogeneity of flavor. If you are not really into really, really spicy chili, and you chopped up half a jalapeno and stuck it in there, well, you'd be happy until you ran across a couple of those pieces, and then you might be a little upset. This way, you chop these things up, then a smoothly, robustly hot jalapeno flavor will persist throughout your chili. Now, be careful when you're chopping up jalapenos like that, or you just saw, I try to be careful. I once saw a guy opening up a can of pickled, I guess, jalapenos, and it was apparently pretty difficult, and so he was holding, it was an institutional size can, and he got some of the jalapeno liquid onto his belly, and his belly began burning, and he had to put his belly in a sink and wash it off. It was was at least good for some comedic relief. All right. So, unused jalapeno. Yeah, we'll put that back. Probably ought to rinse this thing out. I think we had some kind of culture. That's okay. Save that for later. Now, meat is going good. Starting to feel a bit more comfortable about consuming it. Now that we see some heat going through there, you can hear the screams. If you listen real close to the countless microbes that have perhaps made their home in there. Now, this is probably still a little warm, so we'll cool it off before we try to handle it here. All right, drain this off. Everything together. I'm supposed to really rinse these again. I think we've punished them enough. I didn't see anything. You know, watch the water as it's draining out. And you know, make sure that you don't see a bunch of stuff coming off those beans that you don't want to be consuming. And we're going to put 6 cups in there. Now that's important because this whole mixture's got to be just right, because these beans, they're not through consuming water. And I think this is 6, but it looks right anyway. Trying to talk and count at the same time, it ain't working. But, gotta make sure that, you know, you don't dry your chili out while it's cooking in the pressure cooker, which can happen because you can't see it. If you're cooking on an open top, you know, pot, You won't have any problem, because you can just always add some more, you know, bean juice in there or whatever you like to add to it. Some water, keep stuff from drying out in there. But better in a pressure cooker though, as far as losing all the moisture, because it really doesn't have any place to go. You know, you got some that vents off to keep it from blowing up, but I mean, for the most part, it's gonna stay in there. All right, I think we're done with that. Put that in there. Now, one thing I like to do is, I mentioned earlier, I like a little bit of fat content, so flavor and fat both come in a nice package. Bacon. Little trick I learned: cut your bacon up, put it in a storage bag. It's easier to get to, and you're not dealing with a awkwardly long piece of bacon when you're trying to eat it, cut and stuff like that. I just think 5-6 inch piece of bacon is a little bit more, lends itself to consumption a little bit better. So you got some bacon flavor in there. Some extra fat to kind of firm up, gel up that chili. So we got the bacon. Now, I showed you this picture earlier, and I use off the shelf chili, and I've used a lot of them. I use store brand, whatever. Chili powder, I'm not gonna say chili powder is chili powder. The ones I've tried, it's chili. I mean, we're not doing rocket science here. One thing I do is, if you're making a big enough batch, you know, you can mix hot and regular. That's what I tend to do, the hot I don't know, they tend to go a little bit overboard on some of that stuff. And so I like, this is where I like to mix it up. Before I put that meat in there, I'll tell you, the meat, I mean, you really, when it comes to seasoning all this stuff, as long as you get a good, I'm gonna use this word again, homogeneous, as long as you get a good homogeneous mixture of that, of those spices in there, this is why I like to use the dried beans. Those beans are still in there, they've still got some room left in those little dried innards to soak up some stuff. And guess what they're gonna be soaking up now after I put this chili powder in here and this water, along with this bacon and jalapeno, juicy chunk, little tiny chunks of jalapeno and onion. Guess what it's gonna be soaking? It's gonna be soaking up that whole mixture of stuff in there. So those beans, even though I still make Tennessee bean soup, those beans are, they're gonna be packed with chili flavor, plus from the meat, all that stuff. It's all gonna get in the meat. The meat's gonna soak it up too. So, bombs away. This is a two-pack batch here. And I don't know, I think this chili powder's been sitting around for a little while. I keep, just in case there's a nuclear winter or something like that, I usually keep about 20 packs of chili mix in the cabinet. It doesn't go bad. If it does, I haven't been aware of it. Well, I'm gonna mix that. I'm gonna mix that in just a second. Try to mix it with the meat. You know, I used to kind of have this idea, oh, you know, I'll mix up the chili powder with the meat and then put it in there. You know, that kind of fried in it. Well, I mean, it's fried over there. You could fry it into the meat, but shoot, once that meat goes in here and gets pressurized to whatever this pressure cooker is going to get to, about 250 degrees or whatever it is, it's going in that meat. Don't worry about it. This stuff ought to be. Oh, there goes a piece of meat. Hey, buddy. You can't see him, but kitchen police. Get that piece of meat right there. All right. Buddy likes this chili. How I know is he always comes in the kitchen whenever I'm making it. He doesn't get to eat the chili, though. That'd be a misuse of chili. All right, now. So we've got this, right now we've got this mixture of beans and onions and jalapenos and bacon and chili powder ready to go. All we need to do now is add this meat that we're browning right now. And we should be ready to go. So I think we're just about. One thing you can pretty much always count on is a pretty good amount of water content. I don't know if today's, you know, beef cattle just stay real well hydrated or what, but there's always a lot of water content, you know, water's heavy. And I guess that helps make the meat weigh more. So we'll have to cook a little bit more of that. Water off before we get a little bit more browning action. I'm gonna refill my we got some Christmas ale at the same place I got the jalapenos. And when you get a growler, you have to work on it or else it'll go bad. Get a pretty good little core there. Oh yeah, we got it going. All right, seal that up. This is a good little trick I learned. Keep it from going flatter than it otherwise would. All right, stall a little bit. And, Merry Christmas. Get rid of the bacon. I think that meat is just about ready. What do you think? How's that meat, buddy? You like that meat? Is that pretty good? All right. Should be, if Buddy doesn't fall over. Oh, here's another piece. I'm using a lot of meat. A lot of meat in here. And the pan is not exactly industrial size, so getting a little bit of spillage. But I think we're not exactly getting this. Well, we're getting a few little brown spots in there. Turn this up. So I'm going to have to go back and check the video and see exactly how long this is taking. But it shouldn't take that long. You're just about done with anything that you actually have to work at. And see everything. This is everything that's gone into it. And it's not much to keep track of. So once we put the lid on here with that meat packed in there, we're gonna put it on the stove. I like to turn it up pretty high, medium high, and let that steam start going. I may take a video of that if somebody hadn't used a pressure cooker before and they'd like to see how that's done. Once again, this is not for you to do at home, but you'll at least get to see how I do it. And I had a friend of mine, actually a couple of friends. I worked for a while in a laboratory at Georgia Institute of Technology, and there were several guys there who had come there from India. And I learned something very interesting about the preparation these guys went through, initiated by their mothers for how to take care of themselves. Apparently, you know, most of these guys I met, their mothers had taken good care of them, and they'd also made sure that they were ready to take care of themselves. And one of the things was they were taught how to cook. And some of them were really good cooks, but the most interesting thing, or one of the most interesting things that they told me was that their mothers had explained to them that they needed to pack in their suitcase. These guys didn't move over with a big truck or anything like that. They came in suitcases to stay for a couple of years, but to pack a pressure cooker in their suitcase. Because you could not buy a pressure cooker in the United States. People just don't use them. And if you want to cook Indian food in a pressure cooker in the United States, you better have one that you brought with you, because you're not going to be able to go down and buy one. Which is not true. But it is apparently the gospel in India, at least where these mothers hang out. They hear this, and so they tell their sons, pack a pressure cooker or else you will starve when you get there. So that was interesting. All right, I think this meat is about ready. Yeah, I think we're gonna call it. Buddy, what do you think? Is that meat good? Is it good? Buddy falls over here in a second, we might have to change your plan. Now, I do like to keep some of that fat in there, but you know, too much of a good thing after a while. Kinda gotta watch, so put this meat in there. We might chase it. We'll see. It'd just be hard to pour in there. I like to remain in control here. Buddy is he's watching over me. He's making sure that I take care of this meat like I should. Now there's a line in here that says don't fill up past this point. Like I said, this is not an instructional video. Don't do this at home if you feel uncomfortable. All right, but I think that turned out about right. Now, go ahead and get this fired up right there. That's, you know, some stuff kind of floating around up there close to the top. That works out pretty good. Like I said, all I did, the only water I put in there was what is going to go in there and those beans. And in that case, the instructions, the directions turned out to be pretty good. Because those beans do take about that much water. Now, I oiled up this stove. It gets going. That seal, but I'm going to go ahead and go around here and seal and oil this seal here. Yeah. Make sure we got a good surface there. And I learned in hydraulics just how important the surface, the metal surfaces that seals interface with in sealing. If you don't have a good surface, you're not going to have a good seal. Now, we'll seal that up. Make sure you got some movement there, a little safety valve, and we'll set this over here. Oh, it's heavier than I thought it was going to be. All right. That's got a little bit of stuff on there. Now this is where we'll cut out. We'll come back in just a little bit and see. But what I like to do is once it starts, that weight on the top starts dancing around a little bit is when I start my timer, and I run it for about 45 minutes. I could probably go less, but the meat's a little scary, so I've had good luck with 45 minutes, so don't fix what ain't broke. 45 minutes is just 15 minutes longer than 30, and Buddy's still he's still chewing on some of this meat, so it's still a little gummy, and so it could use some good pressure. Medium high, and maybe cut it back down to about medium once you get that weight dancing, and then we'll start back at that. Now we've gotten to the pressurized chili phase, and we're starting to see a little bit of dancing going on here, which that's good, and I'm going to show you the important part about that. Right down here, of course, is the little weight. You see, got quite a bit of pressure going on in there. And if I get pretty close there, you can hear him. You can hear him a little bit. And notice that little pressure valve stood up there. He hadn't gone off, but he's standing tall there. And you see a little bit of dancing. A little bit. Now this one, some weights dance better than others. Now this one doesn't dance very good, but it's got its own thing going on there. Little whirly bird. Oh, we're getting a little steamy. I have to wipe you off there. All right. Now, now that we've got a little dance in the pressure cooker, I'm gonna make sure we're down around. You might be able to see that. Right there at about between a 7 and an 8 on my stove. It might be different on yours, so. But about medium high. And I'll set my timer here for 45 minutes. And we'll let her go.
This is the easy part. Yeah, we've got 45 minutes, and this is the easy part. We'll sit back and relax and wait for chili.
All right, so we've got the chili has come off the stove and cooled down enough where we're not really getting a whole lot of steam. I see I can pick up that weight, and the little safety valve is not stood up anymore. So I'm gonna go ahead and pop the top on this. Once again, just kind of make sure it's not got any pressure in it. You shouldn't be able to slide it open if it's still pressurized, or I shouldn't be able to slide it open. Again, this is my chili. You make yours how you wish. And then it came off rather easily. Take and stir things up there a little bit. Oh, we've got some good stuff going on here. Some beans. Now, sometimes I like to mix a little bit of some green peppers in there and stuff. One thing I didn't do before I locked this up, and it had been on the stove for just a couple of minutes. When I realized this, once I put the meat in there, I didn't really mix it up. But you know what? It doesn't really matter. Because that pressure, all of the spices had been mixed up in the water that the meat had gone into, and it looks like it's done just fine. Everything's gotten mixed together there, and plus chili just gets better and better as you store it. I'm gonna take a little bit out and try it out, see if we've done a good job here. I'm gonna get a good piece of meat, big piece of meat, and some beans in there, and see those pieces of meat there. And I got a spoon, and I'll show you how easy it is to cut that meat up with a spoon. Cut it up with a spoon. The jalapeno flavor will hit you after you've had it in your mouth for a little bit. Scoop up those beans. And the beans, I tell you, they bring a little flavor too. I didn't really salt the meat on this one. And I'm kind of wishing I'd add a little bit of salt. I may add a little bit of salt before I put this up to store. Just to give it a little bit more flavor. But yeah, those beans have definitely soaked that up. It's good stuff. Yeah, that one turned out good. So there it is. It's pretty thick chili. If you like thick, meaty chili with some good flavor, that's one way to do it. Those beans, see those beans? I can pick a couple out here. They've cooked up good. They've held their shape good. I don't know, different beans out there may do differently, but 45 minutes in the chili like this, at pressure, that's there's no fooling around. They're done. So they're good. That's a good pot of chili right there. All we need to do is make pump cornbread, and we're ready to go. So I will enjoy this. You enjoy your chili, and together, we will be much happier people, and the world will be a better place to live in.